Good afternoon and welcome back. Yeah, the first speaker this afternoon is Ed Vandenhuyvel. Ed is an astronomer and emeritus professor at the Astronomical Institute of the University of Amsterdam. His research is in compact stars, black holes, neutron stars, white dwarfs in binary systems, and gamma ray bursts. He is a member of the Royal Netherlands Academy of Arts and Sciences, honorary member of the Indian Academy of Sciences, and the Royal Astronomical Society. I invite Ed to give his talk on the second golden age of Dutch science and the role of nurture for achieving scientific excellence. Ed?
It's a great pleasure to be back here, particularly for this very special occasion of 1,000 moons. For a person in astronomy, of course, that's a fantastic thing to count the time in moons. And it's such a great pleasure to be here with Radhakrishnan. And I think we know each other since about 32 years. The first time I came here was in 1978 on Rad's invitation. And I can only say, Rad, knowing you has very much enriched my life. Seeing astronomers flying airplanes and sailing sailboats and doing all kinds of other things really broadens one very scope of life very much. Thanks very much for the nice 32 years of acquaintance. And also for the acquaintance with the Raman Institute, and particularly also with Professor Srinivasan and the students which you all produced here and which are all over the world. Yeah, I am going not to talk about astronomy as such, but I'm a bit as an amateur historian and sociologist, and so please forgive me if this is not maybe the most exact type of talk you could think of, but when I saw this business of nature and nurture and those type of things, I started thinking about our own physics and astronomy in Holland, and I thought I can make a very strong case for nurture. Nature, of course, is there, and all kinds of other things are there, but I think nurture is extremely important, and that I hope that that message I can convey here this afternoon. How do I move on? Oh, yes. Reality is a pretty haphazard thing, and this was the title of the autobiography of a great Dutch physicist, Hendrik Casimir, the guy who discovered vacuum energy, you could say. And when you think, of course, people, when you talk about nature and nurture, Darwin brought those things on the scheme, and his idea was that by mutations, your genes change, and then nature picks out the best changes and continues with them, and so you will always have the best genes working in nature and also in human beings, selection of the best genetic background of people. But there is another factor, and that is luck. And the famous Harvard biologist Stephen Jay Gould said, bad genes or bad luck? Because, you know, the dinosaurs had been around for 170 million years on Earth. They had fantastically good genes, but then the asteroid hit them, they had bad luck. And so they were extinct. And so if one of our ancestors met a saber-toothed tiger, even if he had good genes, no help for him. So luck is extremely important also, and I would like to include that part. And I just, to give an example, Carl Friedrich Gauss, probably the most talented astronomer since Archimedes, he came from a very poor working class background. And when he was in primary school, His teacher didn't like him because he was so smart. He all the time outsmarted his teacher. And so he got punished and things like that. But lucky enough, there was a help teacher in his school, a guy called Bartels. He came at a certain moment, a boy of 19 years old, and he was studying mathematics, and he saw how bright Gauss was. And this guy Bartels said, this guy is so bright, I should go to the Duke of Brunswick and ask whether the Duke couldn't give that guy a fellowship to go to high school. And the Duke was a generous guy, he gave him a fellowship. So Gauss went to high school, he was very brilliant in high school, so the Duke gave him a fellowship to go to university, and then the whole story, Gauss became the most famous astronomer, a famous mathematician. He was an astronomer, by the way, too, because he was a director of the observatory in Göttingen, but he was the most famous mathematician since Archimedes. And so he had the luck that this assistant teacher came around. If that had not happened, Gauss would just have disappeared and would have become a working class guy. And so I think in Germany and in all over Europe and in India, there are a lot of potential Gausses and a lot of potential Mozarts. But if there is not the right luck and the right environment, nothing will come of it. I mean, they may become smart bricklayers or whatever, but it doesn't help very much. And so the only factor we can influence is not the genes. We cannot influence. So the nature part, we cannot influence. We cannot influence luck either. So the only of the three you can influence is nurture, I think. And what is nature? It's not only genes. Because we know nowadays what happens in the womb of a woman when she is pregnant also has a great influence on what happens to the brain. If a woman is a chain smoker, we now know that the kid will have 5 to 10% less intelligence, IQ, than when the mother is not a chain smoker. And so all kinds of things come in, but yeah, once the child is born, you can't do anything about that anymore, so I don't talk about it. The only thing you can start doing is feed it well and educate it well. That's about what you can do. And I just want to give a case history of the importance of nature by looking at our Dutch physics and astronomy of the last 1.5 centuries. We had the first golden age. I mean, I would be talking about the second golden age, but you can only do that if there was also a first golden age. And the first golden age was in the 17th century when we had people like Lipperhey, who invented the telescope, which then Galileo 1 year later used to look at Jupiter and things like that. Then we had Leeuwenhoek, who discovered bacteria and spermatozoids and all these type of things with his microscope. And we had the biggest guy of our 17th century was Christian Huygens. He was the son of what you could call at that time our prime minister. And this prime minister, his father, thought that the schools were not very good, so he was going to educate the kids himself. He taught his kids science and humanities and sports, horse riding, all those type of things. And the two brothers, Christian and Constantine, later became really great guys. You probably, as physicists, only know Christian, but his brother was one of our famous poets. Now, Christian Huygens, he discovered the law of centrifugal acceleration, V squared over R. He developed a new eyepiece, the Huygens eyepiece for telescopes. The talk of this morning by Kausik, he developed the pendulum clock, which allowed to measure time very accurately, but his work on astronomy and on light, the wave theory of light, is of course the most well-known, and his astronomical discoveries like Saturn's rings and Titan, the big satellite of Titan, all those things. And so the French king, Louis XIV, invited him to become the founding president of the Académie Française. That was our first golden age. And then for about 200 years, nothing happened in science in Holland. The Dutch were just counting their money and doing business, and they were not interested in science. But then in the second half of the 19th century, the government realized that You have to do science to get further in the industrial age. And so two very important things happened in the second half of the 19th century. The first thing is there was created in 1848 a new type of secondary school, of high school, with a lot of science, physics, mathematics, astronomy, chemistry, biology, only a five-year curriculum. The earlier type of high school was 6 years, and most of what you learned there were humanities and Latin and Greek. And this was for the very upper class in general. This school, the Hogere Burgerschool, means the upper middle class school. So it's not the upper class, but the high guys from the middle class were meant to go to that school. And we have had 12 physicists in the Netherlands who got Nobel Prizes. 9 of them got it for physics, 1 for chemistry, and 2 for economics. We never had an economist who got a Nobel Prize for economics. So physics is a much better education for getting a Nobel Prize of economics than economics is as a subject in school. But almost all of them came from that secondary school and not from this Latin Greek gymnasium school. Then the second very important thing was the new law for the universities in 1876, where many new professorships were created in all the universities, and of course the money coming with the professorships. For example, my university in Amsterdam got its first physics professor. We never had one before. Mostly medical things were done, and law and these type of things. And of course, educating ministers for the church. That was one of the main things of our universities. But now we had a physics chair, and all over the country in the different universities, new chairs were created, and a lot of money went in the universities, thanks to this law, for creating laboratories. And right after 1900, you saw the effect of those two things in the form of quite a lot of Dutch guys getting Nobel Prizes. And one of the guys profiting a lot from this new law was Lorentz, who got already at the age of 25, he was appointed on one of those new chairs in Leiden as the first professor of theoretical physics in Holland. And van der Waals, who had never had the possibility, would have not have the possibility to become a professor, he was a principal of one of those high schools, suddenly there was the prospect that he could become a professor, and he was appointed in Amsterdam as our first physics professor at the age of 40 at that time. He was a real self-made type. And then of course we had Zeeman, and van der Waals and Lorentz and Zeeman got the second physics Nobel Prize, for Lorentz for explaining the Zeeman effect and Zeeman for discovering the Zeeman effect. And of course we all know in astronomy that George Ellery Hale then used the Zeeman effect to show that sunspots have magnetic fields. And then we had this other guy, Kamerlingh Onnes. He would never have had a laboratory had not there been that new law we had in 1876. He built his lab in Leiden, he liquefied hydrogen and helium, and then everybody says he discovered superconductivity, but this is not true, because his student discovered superconductivity, and the student is called Gilles Holst. You do not even see him mentioned in the paper of the discovery. That was the custom those days. Shouldn't say bad things about it, but this is the way it happened. But, and then when the director of one of the Philips brothers of our Philips light bulb industry at that time went to Kamerlingh Onnes, they had heard in the United States that Edison and Westinghouse, they had laboratories where you could do new inventions and that could help your industry. And so they thought, we also want a laboratory. And they went to Kamerlingh Onnes and they said, do you have a good student which maybe could start our research lab? And then he said, yes, this is this guy, Gilles Holst, who discovered superconductivity. And he became the founding director of Philips Research. And later he was succeeded by Casimir. Yeah, and you see, of course, Kamerlingh Onnes could do his work only thanks to van der Waals, because van der Waals had made this nice equation of state of gases and liquids, which he used to liquefy these two elements. And then, turning now to astronomy, the same law of 1876 created a new chair in astronomy in the University of Groningen. Why do you need astronomy? Well, Holland had was a seafaring country. We had enormous fleet, and for navigation you need astronomy at that time. And so, and to teach in this high school, there was astronomy because so many people from high school went to the sea. So you needed to teach high school teachers in the university, you needed a professor of astronomy. And so this is why Kaptein was appointed in Groningen, just to teach a little bit of astronomy there. And the rest of the time he was free. And then he joined up with a man in South Africa, David Gill, who had a had no spare time, but was observing a lot, doing a lot of photographic observations, and had no time to work it out. And so Kaptein then measured all these plates from South Africa and got the positions. Well, he did that with a lot of assistance, of course, of about 500,000 stars. And he did it a second time, so you could get proper motions. And then he made his model of the universe, which was wrong, as we all know, because he did not know about interstellar absorption. And so he did not know that there is fog in the Milky Way system. And when you are in the fog, everybody thinks he is in the center of the world because you have a certain distance up to where you can see, maybe 100 meters, and that's all around you. And poor Kaptein did not know about this fog. And so he thought we were in the center of the Milky Way system. But he was the founder of our school of astronomy, and he had two very bright, well, he had a number of very bright students, but one of them was De Sitter and another one was Oort. And so he started our school. All thanks to these two innovations of the second half of the 19th century. He was a very inspiring teacher. And as I said, Willem De Sitter and Jan Hendrik Oort were students. And then later, those guys produced another bunch of students. And at some point, a guy, which I read in the Mercury of the Journal of the Astronomical Society of the Pacific, Mr. Ten, wrote there that nine of the Bruce medals, which is considered as a very high distinction in astronomy, came from this Dutch school, and he said another seven, including the Americans Jesse Greenstein and Alan Sandage, were students, grandstudents, and great-grandstudents of Kaptein. So Kaptein really did something. And what he also did, he had, thanks to the work which he did, a lot of international relations and could send his students to other parts of the world. This is part of this education of your nurture system. And I would like to show some pictures of that. Well, his first PhD student was De Sitter, which you see here. He came from Groningen, but was appointed as a director of Leiden Observatory in 1917. Lorenz, in the meantime, he had grown older than the earlier picture that I showed you, was succeeded by Ehrenfest. And why by Ehrenfest? Well, Einstein had asked Lorenz, who was a good friend of him, Lorenz had asked Einstein, do you know a good guy to succeed me? And then Einstein said, yes, this guy Ehrenfest, he was a professor at the time in St. Petersburg, but Einstein had together with him been professor in Prague. So he knew Ehrenfest and he said, he is good. And so Ehrenfest succeeded Lorenz. And here in 1923, for some reason, Eddington was visiting, and then the son of the sitter took this picture. Thanks to this good physicist, the sitter, of course, could have contact with Einstein already for many years. And recently, it was discovered in the Leiden, a couple of years ago, in the Leiden archives, the correspondence with Einstein, a lot of postcards which Einstein exchanged sent to the sitter. And I just show one of them because it's quite interesting. Nowadays, we talk about dark energy, lambda, the lambda of Einstein's first cosmological model is back, and the sitter used that lambda in his model, which was outdated up to recently. Now that dark energy is back, the sitter is back also. But on this postcard, which was sent in April 1917, as you can see here, 14 April 1917, why did he send postcards? This was because of censorship. It was the First World War, and you could not just send a letter from Germany to another country, and so Einstein was very practical. He just wrote it on a postcard. And it was to the sitter who was in, at that time in a sanatorium, because the sitter had tuberculosis, and from time to time he had to be for fresh air in the countryside, recovering in a sanatorium. And he did most of his best work there, because he didn't have to do administration when he was there. And then he writes, Lieber de sitter, hoffentlich bekommt Ihnen die Ruhe dort recht gut. That's what Einstein writes, nice the sitter, hopefully the rest there will do you good, so that you soon will be in order again. And then he says, it goes well with me also now, thanks to the fact that I'm well taken care of. He had stomach problems because of his divorce at that time. And he had moved in with his niece, with whom he later married, and she apparently cared very well for him. And then he went on about Labda. He says, Eines bleibt jedenfalls. So one thing stands, and that's the general relativity, allgemeine relativitätstheorie, gestattet die Zufügung ein Mitgliedes Labda in die Gleichungen. So the general relativity allows that you put Labda in the equations. And so this is what the sitter then later did and made his cosmological model. This was just a little sideline. But just to show the international relations, thanks to this impulse which came to Kapteyn and the good use that Kapteyn made of it and sending his students to other countries, you see here a meeting of the American Astronomical Society in the year 1923 at Vassar College in the East Coast. And if I just enlarge a little piece of that, there are three young Dutch PhD students on that, Luiten, who was 24, Oort, who was 23, and Van der Kamp, who was 22. Oort was the last student of Kapteyn. He had sent him to Yale University, where he did his PhD work. He had become the assistant first of Van Rijn, the successor of Kapteyn, and Van der Kamp was the successor of Oort as an assistant of Van Rijn, and after that went to Lick Observatory, and Luiten also went to Lick and was now at Harvard. So the fact that you have this system of education and connections, which is part of nurture, was very good for these guys, because here was Shapley, 1923. Shapley had just discovered that the center of the Milky Way is not here, but is in Sagittarius at a large distance by just looking at the globular cluster system. And I am sure that Oort took very good note of that. And then, of course, using a new catalog of radial velocities, Oort discovered the differential rotation of the galaxy and confirmed that the center is, within 3 years he did that, that the center is in Sagittarius about 10 kiloparsecs away. And so all these things help to get a good astronomical system. And you see the guys here, many of these guys educated by the sitter later on, like Bart Bock. This was still a student of Kapteyn, he was at Columbia University, Van der Kamp was at Swarthmore College. The only one who stayed in Holland was Jan Oort. This is at the dedication of the McDonald Observatory just before the Second World War, and Bart Bock was at Harvard at that time. Yeah, and Oort went on, and of course after the Second World War, radio astronomy was a big thing in the Netherlands, and Oort and Van der Hulst started that at that time. And again, our government was nice enough to put up enough money, which is also a part of the nurture system, you know, to put enough money for research in the system to allow him to build his dream, which was the Westerbork telescope, which was dedicated just when he retired in 1970. But again, from the Dutch system, two of the guys sitting here in the front row, Ron Eekers and Miller Goss, who came as postdocs to the Netherlands and then became professors in Groningen, and then subsequently, when a new, bigger telescope was built in the United States, the VLA, Ron became director of that, and later Miller became director. So I still consider these guys part of the Dutch system also, even though Ron does not speak Dutch. Sorry, Ron. And then, yeah, nurture. You know, to show how important nurture and the environment is. 45% of the Dutch, now I'm saying something which I could not say in my country because it is politically incorrect, but it's true, unfortunately. 45% of the Dutch population is Roman Catholic from origin. Only 2 out of these 12 physicists who got the Nobel Prize were from Roman Catholic origin, and altogether, counting chemistry and medicine and the other fields, we had 18 Nobel laureates. Only 2 of them are from Roman Catholic origin. Are the Roman Catholics so stupid? Could that be? Do they have wrong genes? Could that be? No, the bright kids from the Roman Catholic families, they were sent to a Latin school to become a priest. They did not go to the HBS, to the school with science, the secondary school. They went to the Latin school and then became priests. So all the time the cream, the good genes were taken off and went into the clergy. And there was another factor in the Netherlands that the Roman Catholics, for many centuries, the religion was forbidden because we had had a big fight with the Spanish who wanted to burn the Protestants at the stake. And so the Protestants did not like to be burnt at the stake, so they revolted. And so when they won, they forbid the Roman Catholic Church. But these people were still there. But they were basically discriminated quite strongly, also in education, for many centuries. And I'm sure that there are as many little Gausses and Einsteins and Mozarts among our Roman Catholics, but they never got a chance because of these two facts, that the best kids went into the clergy, the brightest kids, and other factors. But it's funny, and the same holds, I mean, for astronomy. I know of no good Dutch astronomer from Roman Catholic origin. It's really amazing. And so, this cannot be the genes. It also cannot be bad luck. So it is just the nurture question, the environment. And another one, I mean, Sommerfeld had more than 10 students who got the Nobel Prize of Physics. That's due to the fantastic environment he created educationally. And I think even Chandra was his student, because as you heard this morning from Srini, Chandra heard from Sommerfeld in Madras when he visited the Presidency College. He heard about quantum statistics, Fermi Dirac statistics, and you could even call Chandra a possible student of Sommerfeld. So, and Sommerfeld himself, by the way, never got a Nobel Prize, which is also funny. Okay, so environment, I think you cannot do anything about genes, you cannot do anything about luck, but you can do enormously much with education. And by creating the right educational system, this is basically the message I would like to bring here. Now, of course, you say, but there are always these exceptional guys. And that is, of course, true. We have had here in India, of course, Ramanujan, and people always point at Einstein, and, of course, people also point at Rath, who never had a PhD or did not go through very formal training, although, sorry, Rath, that we handed you a PhD from Amsterdam at some point, a honorary one, but we took away your innocence, so I'm sorry that we did that. Should never have done that, maybe, I don't know. But you should not forget that Einstein went to excellent secondary schools in Switzerland and to the best university, still one of the best in Europe, the ETH in Zurich. And Rath, of course, had quite some environment here, I would think, from which he could pick up something. So, but Ramanujan was the real exception, I think. But he had luck that there was an Englishman who noticed that apparently this guy was doing some good things, and he had the other luck that this man got him into contact with Hardy in Cambridge, and that Hardy was a very generous guy, like this high school, this primary school help teacher of Gauss, who really recognized it and wanted to recognize it. I think there would be lots of famous mathematicians who would just have ignored it, but he had the luck that Hardy did not ignore it. But Ramanujan is really a very exceptional case. He came basically out of nothing. So that sometimes does happen. But my main my main theme is that still nurture, I think, a very large part for achieving scientific excellence is played by the environment. We stand all on the shoulders of giants, as Newton said. The world is full of bright people, of little Mozarts, of little Gausses. The right genes are, and I think there must be thousands and thousands in India, but you need the right environment, and that's a combination of nurture and the luck, which nobody can do without. My father was a businessman, and he always said, without luck, nobody fares well, and I think that's also a very important thing. But we cannot do anything about luck. Thank you.
Pendulum that Huygens built, he put it in the cusp of a cycloid,
yes,
so that the period was independent of amplitude, unlike the simple version I had shown you.
Yes, yes. But that was the reason why his clock ran so well. Yes.
I'd like to take issue with you that you can't do anything about luck. I think you can. This I'll be talking about day after tomorrow, actually, but I'll make the point now. So Einstein was doing very badly as a patent clerk. He'd been knocked back for promotion, and yet had the gall to send off these papers,
yes,
on relativity. And as we all know, the rest is history. But for how many other young Einsteins were there who maybe didn't quite have the gall to send off those papers, or still being knocked back because they didn't have the right social skills, or maybe they just got dismissed, who's going to even referee this paper from this,
yes,
second-class patent clerk. In India, how many kids are there, well, I'm only picking on India because we're here, it's true in every country, how many kids are there who don't have the educational opportunities and so on? And so, now being very pragmatic, I'm not talking about equal opportunity or anything like that, I'm being pragmatic. If we want to get the best brains into science, we've got to go out and find those Einsteins living in some Indian village, yeah, without good education, but with a brain the size of a planet. And the internet actually gives us the opportunity to do that. And I think we don't have to rely on luck. We can make luck,
okay,
to find those other Einsteins.
Well, that's a fantastic message. So please repeat it as strong as you can, because that's indeed true. Yes, you could do it nowadays. Yeah.
Ed, I was just thinking, as you were showing the Westerbork pictures, if you compare the development of aperture synthesis in Cambridge and what happened in the Netherlands, you notice a big difference. The Cavendish group were quite introverted and closed, whereas Jan Oort searched for the best people to help build that telescope anywhere in the world.
Yes.
And brought in all of these foreigners. So yes, it is something about the culture in the Netherlands that is very open to...
It is also the persons themselves. I mean, Kaptein had already that attitude. He sent the sitter to South Africa to do the work for his PhD thesis on the satellites of Jupiter. And then the sitter also had many international, I mean, he was the chair of the international, president of the International Astronomical Union at some time. And whether everybody in Holland has this international, it's particularly strong for the astronomers and the physicists. Well, we are a small country. We're basically the delta of the Rhine and a couple of other rivers, as you probably know. And the Maas and the Schelde, three big rivers who come together there. And since we are so small and we have very big neighbors, and all our trade is with the big neighbors, of course, everybody has to speak the language of the Germans and of the French and of the English. And a very sad thing is that this good school was abolished, the good secondary school, in 1968. And so now French and German are no longer compulsory, which is extremely stupid because they are our two greatest trade partners. So only English is now compulsory. Our school system, unfortunately, has decayed. And yeah, what can you do about it? Stupid bureaucrats who think of new things. Yeah.
I'd like to draw your attention to the possibility that in history, at different times of point of history, in some places, a lot of good people came together. Now we are talking about individual matching. But if you think of Florence for arts and so on,
yeah.
or Vienna, or yeah. Hungary, or yeah. Göttingen, and when I think of Sommerfeld, it's not that the 10 students, the fact that such students came together also perhaps inspired each other.
Oh, absolutely.
A critical mass kind of thing.
Absolutely.
And when I look at Cambridge, that's what I feel. The fact
yes.
that, you know, in a place like that, you don't have just one individual excellence, but a lot of people. I think that is very necessary, I feel. Otherwise, the individual, like Ramanujan and so on, can flourish for some time, but is lost. But if you have a group, it seems to resonate and strengthen each other. Would you like to comment on that?
I fully agree with what you say there. And I mean, the formation of a school, but it has to come from somewhere at the beginning. Like Kaptein was the first, but he created a school, you could say, of people who cross-fertilized each other. And you saw the same with Sommerfeld, of course, who had the first German Institute for Theoretical Physics. And of course, if there is a very good teacher, they attract also. The good students want to go there, which is it creates a collective effect. I mean, you have the same here in the Raman Institute, I presume. And this creates a collective effect. Yes. Yeah, they not certainly not always have a long life. I mean, it depends also on the persons, of course. And the persons are important. But, yeah, you cannot do much about those things, I think. I was only talking about things where you really can do. And I think what I call nurture or educational system, create a good system also of funding. Because if there is no funding, Kamerling Onnes would never have been able to build his lab if there had not been funding. And Oort would never have been able to make his Westerbork telescope. He always said to us, at that time we were deep in the Cold War in the 1960s, and Holland had just ordered 150 Starfighter planes. You know, we were a member of NATO, like Germany, France, everybody. He said, Westerbork is just the price of one Starfighter. That was the only comment when we said, it's so expensive, how could you get the money? Well, he was clever in convincing our government, but he just said it's one starfighter. And that was it. Yeah. And as you know, our prince of the Netherlands at that time got some extra money from the starfighter order by bribing someone. Oh, this is terrible to talk about.
Kaptein was very important for founding the school, and I've been curious, why was it that I'm sure that extinction was in the data he had on stars. And,
yes.
I asked Oort one time, how was it that they missed extinction? Now, you know, Jan is a very gentle person, and he didn't. Obviously, he did not want to answer that question. Do you have any insight into how it was that Kaptein missed extinction? He also, seeing the star streaming, that came awfully close to, if you were a better physicist, he would have thought of gravity.
Yes, yes, you are absolutely true. The point was, he realized that there was interstellar matter because people had been seeing interstellar lines. They were known. I mean, in 1919, Miss Hager, who later married Donald Shane, so she no longer you could recognize her name, she was Mary Lee Shane, she discovered the interstellar sodium lines, I think, and the calcium lines had been discovered 10 years earlier. So people knew that there was matter. But Kaptein had no clue how he could correct for it. And so he said, I'm not going to do sloppy things if I don't know how to correct. He was aware that it existed, but he could not correct for it. And I, this is my understanding of the situation.
Bernard made a beautiful photographic atlas of the Milky Way about 1909. And the interstellar dust is there, plain as can be seen. On
the yes, but there was no way to correct for it. I mean, Trumpler in the 1930s was the first one who discovered a method how you could correct for it.
Yeah.
And Kaptein didn't know how to correct for it. What can you do about it?